Hey, what up, my comic book peeps? It's your boy J-Rox. Today I'm coming at you with another graphic novel haul. Got a nice healthy stack of graphic novels. I got for about $35. They were $7 each. So let's get to what I got here. Alright, now the first book, if you guys know, I've been trying to collect my X-Men run and trades and hardcovers and whatnot. And also I try to get a few like Excalibur, X-Factor, the other X-Universe titles that were going on from like 1980 and 1990. Right here I got Peter David's X-Factor, Volume 1. Now, if you saw my last haul, I got Volume 3 and 4, so now I picked up Volume 1. All of these I got in a used lot. They're all, none of them are new. This has this like, you know, minor thing here. It's no big thing. It's not that big a deal. It doesn't affect the way I read it. Now this one covers issues 71 through 75. Issue 72 being the first full issue where this new team appears. Being Polaris, Strong Guy Guido, Havoc, Wolfsbane, and Multiple Man. Madrox, I believe was his name. At the back of it. Okay, now this is leading. This is after the X-Men Extinction Agenda. The X-Factor title used to be the original X-Men: Cyclops, Jean Grey, Beast, Angel, and I think that was it. And Iceman. Okay, so after the Extinction Agenda, they changed the team. The title continued with the same numbering system. It continued on issue 81 and 82 and so forth. But it became a new team once Peter David jumped on the board. He started it with a new team, being this team. And it was no longer Cyclops and Beast and so forth. There were a lot of the writers were doing that at that time. He started his new team with this, even though it's the same existing title. Just like Rob Liefeld started the X-Force, even though it was still New Mutants, he rechanged the name to X-Force, and it became a whole new team with Cable, Domino, so forth, with all new characters he created. Now, I'm not sure, but I believe this is a new character here, Strong Guy. The rest of them were already existing characters from other X-Men titles. It runs about 136 pages, I believe. Let me see. Yeah, 136 pages. It's nice gloss paper. I don't mind when it's not gloss paper. The only bad thing with that is that it can get yellowing. Like I have this one, Volume 1, and I have Volume 3 is with the gloss paper. Then Volume 4 is with regular paper, which I don't know why they did that. If they did the first three volumes with this paper, might as well make the fourth one so they cannot match. And these two are like nice and white, bright white like that, and shiny pages. And the other one is yellow up here. It's like yellowing, but inside the pages are just fine. Get some into some of the artwork. These are Larry, some of the art right there. Get an idea. What's this guy's name? Larry Strom. Okay, the next book is Wolverine, the Jason Aaron collection. This is volume one. Pretty thick book, nice chunky size trade paperback. I'm really enjoying reading these thick trade paperbacks like this. I think I enjoy reading them more than the hardcovers. I like the way the hardcovers look and when they're on the shelf and all that, and they also come with a lot of extra content and sketches and so forth on the end, and the trades, they don't know, that's not always the case. But when I'm actually holding and reading it like this, I'm a lot more comfortable holding this like this. It feels more like a magazine or a comic book than when I'm reading a hardcover book. That just feels like totally different. But yeah, got this one, Jason Aaron. This has a bunch of different writers. One thing I didn't like about this, I'm currently reading it. I got this right here. I'm about done with it. I might do a review on it, so stay tuned for that. One thing I definitely didn't like about this is, look, it covers issues, the Wolverine, the second series from 2003, covers issues 56, then 62 through 65. Then it skips to 73 and 74, then Wolverine Manifest Destiny 1 through 4. So I don't see why it doesn't go from 56, then it skips to 62, then after 65, it skips to 73. Why not go from issue 56 all the way to 74 all in a complete run? Because some of the stories, in like halfway through a story, it's just like one issue and it, and you don't know what happens. It doesn't continue and it just completely skips to a new story, which is kind of odd. I don't know why they would do that. Like in one here, he's trapped somewhere and he's escaping and it's to be continued. So you think the next issue you're going to see what happens and it just skips to the beginning of a new story. And it's like, why didn't you put the issues in between? I didn't get that. I really didn't like that. Now I'm like, I don't know, do I pick up the singles or what I do, those singles in between? It's like four or five issues in between to continue what happened from when he escaped onto the new story arc, onto how he got into the predicament of the new story. I don't know, I wasn't really feeling that. So I still want to continue the rest of the Jason Aaron run. I think there's four of these, so I'll be buying all four. You'll be seeing them in my future hauls. But all right, now if you've seen some of and one of my previous hauls, I bought the X-Men Onslaught Omnibus, and I seen they had this, which I didn't know about, Road to Onslaught. So there's three paperbacks of these, pretty thick, guys. Look, big chunky books. They're about 488 pages, I believe. It has this. Whenever they have this, it means they're overstocked. Like they're just trying to get rid of them. They have a bunch, and they usually end up selling them to you real cheap. This goes for a cover price of $40. I got this for $7. Now, this, I believe it's going to be on the Road to Onslaught. So, obviously in the Onslaught storyline, Professor X's powers, his psychic abilities, merges somehow with Magneto's magnetic powers or something like that, to my understanding. I haven't read the Omnibus yet, even though I have it. I want to read these first to see how we got there. So I'll be buying the other three. The art on this, it's alright. I don't mind it. Some of the art. Now, this has a lot of different artists and writers here because it's crossovers from a bunch of different books. Look, it's Uncanny X-Men, 327 and 328. 1991 X-Men, 46 through 49. And what is it here? Sabretooth Special, 1995 Sabretooth Special. Now this paper is not that glossy kind. It's the regular kind, which I don't mind because I usually read right here under the light. So it's not glaring. Like when it's glossy paper, the glare is there. And when I'm reading, I have to like move it at an angle where it's not shining so I could read it. Then when I get to the next part, now the light's over here. So then I got to move it back this way. And when it's like this, I don't got to bother with all that shit. So I really like this a lot more. But yeah, guys, trip out on that. This thick ass book for alright, and like I was saying, and then I got this thin book also for $7. They were all the same price. So trip out on that, like the difference between this and that. Or that. They're all different sizes. Now the thing though with this one's it's like a little rare, a little harder to find. It's out of print. I've gone to eBay and Amazon and all that. This one's always tends to go for around 20, so 7 was a pretty sweet deal. Now this one, got it also for 7, but this one's usually, you can always find it cheap, $8, $10. You always find it pretty cheap because this one, like I told you, has this thing here. That means they're overstocked. They printed a bunch of them and ordered a lot more than they ended up selling, so now they're selling them at real cheap prices because they're having a hard time getting rid of them. You know, make space for new inventory and so forth. Alright, my next book is this one, Ultimate Spider-Man. Death of Spider-Man Prelude, it says right here. This covers issues 150 to 155 from Brian Bendis' run on Spider-Man, which would be the Ultimate Spider-Man. Oh, also it includes art from Sarah Pascelli. I really love her art, really feeling it. When I got back into comics about a year ago, she was one of the persons that really stood out to me when I read current comics. And you know, when I'm reading and I'm looking at the interiors and so forth, her art was one of those that just stood out. I was like, whoa, you know, like, this person's good. I'm feeling what they're doing. I just don't see her art in a lot of stuff. Like, I don't know if she just doesn't do a lot of not working a lot of titles or what's going on, but really digging it. You know, let me show you a few of the interiors so you could get an idea of what I'm talking about.
Right, check out Samacero's art right here. Look at here, you see this girl daydreaming. Someone's creeping up behind her. I don't know, I believe that's Gwen Stacy. Look at the next panel, she's getting a little closer. Something happened and now she's running backwards. You see, she's running back to the door. Now she's back again. Whatever happens here on this next page, you see her, whoops, my bad. You see her, you know, stressing out there? Look at how the... You can see it go from that to that. I really love the way her art flows. It's just like one of those motion cartoons when you flip the pages real fast. And each page, it moves just a little bit. And when you flip them out fast, it's moving in motion. It's kind of what it does here. See if we could find some pages with a Spider-Man on there. Check this shit out right here. You see he does a kick, it gets blocked off. While this other guy swinging at him and hits him. Right after the kick, boom, he knees him in the stomach. Now trip out on this, trip out, look. Knees him in the stomach, grabs him, turns him around so that she could hit him instead. Puts him in front of him, she kicks him instead. Then he moves him out of the way, spider webs her, and jumps up and blah blah, kicks both of them. Now look at that in motion real quick. Boom, knee to the stomach, turn you around, blah. Spiderweb you, boom, hit both of you. That's an awesome action scene there. Like, you really see it like moving right before your eyes. Like, it feels like it's in motion. That's what Sarah brings to the table, guys. It's awesome stuff. Could tune some of these other panels real quick. Also, Spider-Man. If you guys are familiar with Deadpool, Spider-Man is like he likes to break the fourth wall. He's very comedic and sarcastic, very like immature. That's what makes his book a fun read though. And back in like in the 90s when Deadpool got created, he was based off of a Spider-Man, similar suit. It was red also, and he also was comedic, and then eventually he also started breaking the fourth wall just like Spider-Man. Now a lot of people like to make the comparison to Deathstroke. But originally, it was based off of Spider-Man's costume. And Rob Liefeld touched on that in an interview before. And I agree with him. It's true. I do believe him. Because he says, oh, people think it was copied after Deathstroke. It was after Spider-Man. I do believe this because when Deadpool was a new character, not everybody knew about him. He was new. He barely had like 2 issues out where he appeared in. I knew about these issues. Because I followed X-Force, I followed the X-Men universe, X-Men, X-Force, New Mutants. And so I knew who Deadpool was right when he came out. He was the villain to Cable. And a lot of people didn't know that. So when they would see Deadpool, I would remember hearing in the stores other little kids my age and stuff like, oh, look, it's Spider-Man. And a lot of people thought like, oh, that's Spider-Man's new suit. Because in the 90s, he was constantly wearing all kinds of different suits. So like, oh, that's a new Spider-Man suit, this and that. Then eventually you find out that was a new character, Deadpool. And he was also funny like him and so forth. So, yeah, I heard him say that McFarlane would bust his chops. Like, oh, you know, I drew 5 pages, you're barely on one. He said, oh, it's because Cable's real detailed. He has all kinds of pouches and guns. And Spider-Man suit's real easy to draw. You could get a lot of panels done quick. And he said, look, I'm gonna draw characters that's real simplistic like yours, so you could see how I could get go through pages quick too. So he created Deadpool based on Spider-Man and kind of to mock McFarlane and made him funny like Spider-Man. Said, look, I could create a character like the one you're working with, because they were real good friends, so you know they'll mess with each other like that. And eventually, you know, he started breaking the fourth wall as well like Spider-Man, but he was originally the first one to do all that. Just for those of you that don't know, if you like Deadpool, you will like Spider-Man. Alright, I think, yeah, I showed most of the art right here.
Alright, guys, the last book of the haul is This one, Ultimate Spider-Man, Death of Spider-Man. Bam, you see him there, jacked up, ready to, call it a day. You know, it's a wrap. Spoiler, guys, Spider-Man dies here. And, that's it. It's a dandata. And this is where you would make the debut, I believe, of Miles Morales Spider-Man. And it'll still be Bendis on that run. Now, this covers issues 156 through 160. It continues off from this. Now, I don't know why they didn't just make a deluxe hardcover with both of these, covering these 10 issues in one oversized, thicker book. Because when they're thin books like this, I almost prefer getting the trade over the hardcover, if that makes sense. I have the first four volumes in a deluxe size hardcovers, so that's really the first eight trades. I prefer getting hardcovers for that reason, because if a series runs 10 trades, instead of buying 10 books, I could just buy five hardcovers that covers two trades each book. I just find that more convenient. It's less shit to deal with. Now, I picked up those Spider-Man Deluxe hardcovers. I got volume 1 to 4. I got those for like $3-$4 each, which was the whole reason why I just said, you know what, let me pick them up. Or else, that wasn't really anything on my radar or anything on my list. Since they were cheap, I said, let me get them. Then I hear good stuff. I hear it's a good run, that Bendis run on Spider-Man. I heard his run on Spider-Man and his run on Daredevil is the way to go. So, you know, I said, let me pick them up. Pretty cheap, why not? I saw them in a lot on eBay, and all they really had is you know what, let me show you guys. All right, I'm back. Now see, like this one, they're nice oversized books. See how much thicker it is? This covers two trades, like it would be the equivalent of these two. It covers 12 issues. It's about 350 pages or so. I'm guesstimating, don't quote me on that. But it is the first 12 issues. And look at the only problem with these is like it comes with this. You see how it has this sticker on the dust jacket? And it has another sticker here. I check the book itself, it's in great condition. I take the dust jacket off. It's real nice looking, it's real sexy. But just the dust jacket has those two stickers, and this is about a $40 book, $40 cover price. I got these for like $3. I got four of them, the first four volumes. So trip out on that. And I got these for $7, and look how much thinner it is. It's funny like that with comics, guys. It doesn't matter how much content you get. This could be so cool and a lot better read than this, and a lot more pages. That doesn't mean that it's gonna cost more. It goes by availability. Like this is the beginning of the run. It was very popular, sold a lot. So there's tons and tons of copies they made because it's a popular storyline, whatever. So there's more millions and millions, whatever, of printed out there, right? Of these books printed out there. So they're just available everywhere, and hence, you know, they have to drop the price because either everybody already has them or whatever, right? So it just really goes by the popularity of the book. Sometimes it works in your favor. The more popular a book is, probably the more there's gonna be out there, and you know, end up costing you a lot less. And if it's a lower print run because it didn't sell as much, it's gonna, you know, most likely cost you a lot more because it's gonna be harder to find. Yeah, but anyways, I'm rambling now. You know, that's all I got for you guys today. You know, if you like what you saw, you like watching hauls, see what people purchase, give you a vague idea of what their reading habits are, like, or what my reading habits are. Or maybe I show you something that you're like, oh, I didn't know that existed. It piqued my interest. I want to buy it. Then, you know, that's a good way to find out. That's why I like watching hauls myself. And also, sometimes when they talk about the book, I'm like, hey, it sounds interesting. Okay, but yeah, so if you like what you saw, hit that subscribe button. Also, stay tuned for my Wolverine review. I'll probably do a review on it once I finish reading it. And, you know, check it out. I always like to, you know, hear you guys chime in if you also read it, you know, give me your, you know, post your comments, your opinions on what you thought of the stories. Or if you read one of these that I just got that I haven't read, you know, what you think of it. Or also based on what I have here, if there's something you think I might like based on this stuff that might be my style, you know, any recommendations, post them down there, guys. And, oh, one more quick thing. If you guys didn't follow me on Twitter, check me out on Twitter. I'm under JRocks1, JAYROX underscore ONE. You know, follow me there. Always chop it up about books or sports, whatever, online there. And that's about it, guys. I'll check you guys out next time.